79 degrees in South Florida. That's it for now. I'm Juan. Neil is next on Talkin' Entertainment Radio, 610 WIOD.
Talkin' Entertainment Radio, 610 WIOD, Miami, Fort Lauderdale. Talkin' Entertainment Radio, 610 WIOD of Pax & Company presents The Neil Rogers Show. To talk to Neil, call 751 WIOD in Dade, 524 WIOD in Broward. Outside Dade and Broward, call 1-800-944 WIOD. AT&T Wireless and Bell South Mobility callers can use pound IOD. Now, The Neil Rogers Show on Talkin' Entertainment Radio, 610 WIOD.
It's Friday, you bastards.
She's back. She's bad. And she's mad.
Shut up!
Barbara Bush. She and her posse are tracking down the world's biggest bad guy.
So bad. What are you going to do to that yellow-bellied sidewinder once we catch him?
Well, first I figure I'll teach that mangy varmint to read. And then I'll string him up.
Yeah, right.
She's judge and jury in her own kangaroo court. It's Hang 'Em High, starring Barbara Bush and Clint Eastwood.
Looks like he's hightailing it towards the east.
Slim!
Yeah!
You and Gabby ride on ahead and cut him off at Literacy Pass.
Let's go!
Hussein can run, but he can't hide.
He's got a date with a tall camel and a short rope.
Barbara Bush in Hang 'Em High.
Hi-ho, Silverhair! Away!
What are you trying to say,
what
George?
Is it?
So anyway, it's 10:03 at WIOD. Happy Friday morning. Boy, did we have an uplifting experience yesterday.
Oh!
Wow. Got the tour of the new WIOD studios up there in Hollywood, and I'm going to tell you something you could eat off the floor. You have never seen anything so majestic, so state-of-the-art, so phenomenal. You've never seen anybody, especially after what we've gone through the last three, 4 years. I mean, we can't even get a paperclip in this joint. These people have spent zillions of dollars, and it's only the beginning. To give us state-of-the-art, we're going to be able to do stuff up there that you wouldn't even believe. But anyway, before we get to that, we got a great hockey section in the USA Today, by the way, even if you're not one of those regular people that likes the color pictures. USA Today has got a bonus pullout section today on the hockey season, which begins tonight, of course. And it's great. I mean, it has got more crap in here. And it also says Maple Leaf Sergei Berezin leads talented rookie corps. That's the only thing we got. If he scores 150 goals this year, Leafs might have a chance. But it's got all this great stuff on here. It's got about the different teams, about the dynasties are hard to build. It's got all the rosters of every team. It's got a synopsis on each team, who they pick, who they don't. Panthers, by the way, they pick, looks to me like they're picking us third behind the Flyers and the Rangers in our division. Which at least is better than that hockey show the other night where they picked us fourth. Although it has a few caustic comments. And nobody believed in us last year, so why should they believe us this year? And then it's got the team-by-team schedules on the last inside page for all the teams in the league. So if you're a hockey fan, even if you don't have TCI, this is definitely something you ought to get USA Today today. Also, speaking of TCI, while I was up there in Hollywood with our people, Pete Bolger tells me the good news, the first complaint already. We haven't even moved into the new building yet. They already got a phone call yesterday. Guess who? From TCI.
Oh!
Oh, they're upset. Poor babies. They're upset. They're upset because I got an ear. And I gave that phone number out in their internal memo. It says that, what's her name there? She wants to hear from the customers. And she evidently got 10 million calls. And she's a little upset. He's going on here saying this and saying that and to call us. Yeah, we want people to call you. Because now it's Friday. The opening game is tomorrow night. And you people are still diddling around and are trying to put off the public. And people are getting pissed off. So anyway, Jeff Rimmer is here this morning, and you can ask him whatever you want, right?
Absolutely. The Panthers begin the season tomorrow night. We're heading off to Philadelphia this afternoon, and we may get an update before we leave the air today with regards to DirecTV.
Yeah.
And the hope is that by tomorrow night, and it doesn't look like TCI will be on board.
No.
But, hopefully,
they will
DirecTV,
not be on board by tomorrow night.
There'll probably be a mad rush to Brandsmart and all the other spots.
Well, yeah, but don't forget this, and that is, there are a lot of people who have DirecTV who may not be real big sports fans, so
right.
They only have the basic package.
Yeah.
But if they have the basic package and they find out that if they get the sports package, they're going to get Sports Channel Florida on there, they'll be on the phone with DirecTV like immediately, if not sooner. Of course, they can do that right over the phone.
As
they
we can... speak, negotiations continue, from what I understand, between the East Coast and the West Coast, and the hope is that something will be done.
Yeah. Why do you keep playing that in the background, George? Just because Rimmer is here? So anyway, we got Jim Leland is coming to manage the Marlins.
Great.
Oh,
great.
We got the umpires walking out. More trouble with baseball, which they just keep shooting themselves in the leg. And the beat
goes
on.
We're going to talk to Doug MacLean here in the next few minutes.
We're
going to
talk to Doug MacLean. I got a great suggestion on something he might shop for you up in Philadelphia. I know they don't have any here.
Well, we should also probably call Don Cherry.
We might call Don Cherry. And, we might kill some good time so Rimmer can avoid the obvious and can evade growing up and being a man. One thing I want to warn you on this show at any given moment here in the first part of the show today.
Beware of exploding balls.
But don't worry about it too much. That's my suggestion, okay? That even Jennifer knew. She knew what was going on. Well, this man is caught. Let me just, I don't want to alibi for you, but you're caught between a rock and a hard place is what you said, which is a good excuse for the fact that you're just holding out. The man hopes someday he gets a job. He hopes that somebody hires him besides Sports Channel Florida. He's only going to be busy doing 65 hockey games, probably on a baseball telecast, doing pregame and postgame and all kinds of other stuff. He's going to be working 13 months out of the year, but he's just holding out that hope that the phone is going to ring. And who do you think is going to be on the other end? Maybe it'll be Hank.
Well, just a couple things I will straighten out here.
Will you?
I will.
All right, here we go.
Number one.
Yes.
Number one, I mean, we don't need any fanfare. Number one, I guess Hank, and I didn't hear it, but Hank the other day, I'm told that he said I was suing two people at QAM, which is just totally untrue.
Yeah.
As you know, and I think everybody here in South Florida knew back, I guess it's several months ago now,
yeah.
Some things were said on the morning show. About my son, Josh.
Right.
Were totally inaccurate. There was a young high school soccer player with the name Grimer or Grimes or something.
Grimer.
That stepped on some kid's head in the whole nine yards. And I guess the boys were having some fun, but the one guy in particular, which was the guy that I had all my problems with when I was at QAM, was Joe Zagacki.
Mm.
And, you know, he said, well, it's a cheap shot. What do you expect? Look at who his father is. But anyway... We asked for the tapes.
Joe Zagacki sucks, okay?
Because we
okay.
never heard that.
Yeah.
And if it was anybody else that has a son, and all, the, and again, he's not in the public eye, and no need to even talk about the kid, but for that to erroneously be said when everybody knows where we live in Coral Springs, and here was this kid in Hollywood stepping on somebody else's head,
mm-hmm.
we just thought that we should listen to the tapes, etc. But we listened to them, and not to make a mountain out of a molehill, we just decided to walk away. Right or wrong, we decided to walk away. So there was never any lawsuit.
Yeah.
Well, you know.
You're not suing anybody there.
Right.
Yeah.
And, well... Hank can say what he wants to say, and I'm not going to get down to his level, but the
but
fact...
But where did this all start? Didn't you get along with him when you were over there? I
Hank
mean, you
was
were on
great.
The air there.
Hank was great to me.
Right.
He really was.
So where did this
Hank
problem
was the
start?
Guy... Well,
did the problem start
I had
when
my
you started
battle...
coming on his show?
Probably.
Yeah.
Probably. And allegedly, I also started a rumor, he says, that he was going to New York, which I did not start. The fact of the matter is, and I remember as if it was yesterday, we were sitting in Ottawa, and Ron Colangelo, who's now the PR guy for the Florida Marlins, and Chris Moore, myself, and Ray Murray were sitting there having lunch,
yeah.
And it was Chris Moore and Ron Colangelo that were conversing and telling us what the story was with Hank. And the long and short of it is, and I know it as true as it is today, that Ray Murray came back to me and apologized because he told his editors, hey, you better check on this because there's a story in Ottawa that Hank may be going to New York to WFAN.
Mm-hmm.
Bottom line in all this, I mean, that's a promotion. I mean, Hank working at... the best sports radio station in the country. But anyway, Hank felt that it was me that started the rumor, and he's been telling people, I guess, on the air ever since. That, too, totally
well, he's
inaccurate.
He's used that as an excuse to justify the relentless, endless attacks against you. But it's interesting, because I remember Andy Kalb was the one. Even you didn't tell me that. Andy Kalb was the one, I don't know where he heard it, who came to me and said, I hear that Hank's going to the FAN. That's the rumor. And, of course... You know me, I always take that stuff and go with it because, you know, that's just the way we do it here.
Well, I talked to Ray Murray. I talked to Ray Murray, the Sun Sentinel, and
yeah.
I got in kind of his face. I said, listen, I said, you don't need to be making problems for me. I mean, I work with Hank, and Hank was pretty upset the first time we talked about it. But I thought at the end that I'd convinced him, after he actually did a tirade against Ron Colangelo on the air, that it wasn't me who started the rumor.
So is he going to FAN?
No.
Next to Don in the car phone. Hello, Don.
Hey, Ham, how you doing?
Okay, great.
I was at the Hurricane game on Saturday.
Yeah.
Good game.
It was great.
Yeah, although we lost, it was packed, though. But I want to know if you're going to the Fan or not in New York.
No.
You're not?
No.
There was a report that said that you were going to the Fan in New York by the end of the month.
I've never talked to the Fan in New York, and I wouldn't lie to you.
I heard it on IOD on the...
Well, you know, I'm sorry, but it's not true. I don't care where you heard it.
Well, that's what they said. They said
what's
going...
the difference what they said?
So
I'm telling you, no.
I mean, there's been two reports already.
That station is BS radio from sign-on to sign-off, and I can't believe how many suckers there are in this town who are sitting there listening. Last week, Neil retiring. Do you remember that?
Even Neil Rogers and Phil Hendry, BS radio.
Excuse me. Last week they said Neil was leaving, didn't they?
Yeah.
Is he leaving?
No, but that was a fool. That was a...
Yeah, right.
So we got a little exercised about that, and, let me say it again. There were other people who started a rumor. Andy Cal passed it along, and I ran with it. And I'll be honest with you, I keep hearing those rumors again. I think Hank might be going to FAN in New York.
I don't want to be involved in that. I mean, you know, Hank can say what he wants to say, but there is reality, and I'm not going to get down dirty with Hank because, again, Hank was one of the guys that did go to bat for me while I was at the station. He and Joe Rose.
Yeah.
And quite frankly...
Well, now he's using the bat in other ways, I guess.
Well, what can I say? But I'm not going to get down to that level, but I don't want those things being used as excuses because they're not. When probably in reality, the big reason why Hank's... upset with me is probably because I make all these appearances on your show.
Yeah. And probably because he doesn't know anything about hockey, and this is a good cover-up for it, is that during the playoffs when there was such an intensive amount of interest and people were just dying to hear more information about the Panthers and about the playoffs, is that it put him in a very difficult position, and it was only after the playoffs were over, sometime later on, that he finally admitted he doesn't know anything about it. So it seemed to me that he would be anxious. I mean, if you want to be on a so-called all-sports station, wouldn't you want to have people on who know something about sports that you don't know about? You would think.
Hank, I'm telling you, when I used to go in the afternoon, Hank would start laughing. He said, you know what, Rimmer, you're a
to
breath
your
of fresh air.
Yeah,
you're a breath
face.
Of fresh air. And no, he did go to bat for me with the powers that be. But by that time I was buried by Zagacki because, I mean, you can't believe some of the stuff that went on in that station in my short stay there. And quite frankly, the best time I had there at QAM is one of the 3 weeks that I worked the morning show with Joe Rose. And I got on there because Joe said, hey, listen, I want to work with this guy. I want this guy on the morning show. And Joe's the guy. And the fact of the matter is, when the lawyer's letter went to QAM and Joe got wind of it, and Joe talked to me, and actually didn't talk to me very much, but you know that he was pretty upset about it. But I said, Joe, my problem is not with you. The problem was the inaccuracies of Zagacki, and I think that right from day one, we had problems there. I mean, I one time co-hosted a show with Joe Zagacki, and people in the building were appalled because he was running down the hall, couldn't get to the old owners quick enough to... bitch and complain that I was put on his show without his knowledge.
Too much hockey talk.
It was crazy.
Hockey.
No, it's also...
Leave the hockey to Joe.
You want to do good sports talk radio, and you know that radio is my love.
Right.
All right? Next to the Florida Panthers and hockey, radio is my first love. You want to do good sports radio, I worked at one of the great stations in America, WBAL in Baltimore, for 10 years. You're guest-intensive. You're issue-oriented. You get to the people that are making the news. Last week, when this story broke on the baseball umpire, I knew about it 8 hours before about the umpires potentially walking out. I talked to the umpire that was the crew chief there.
I thought the way they were just have a bunch of pimply-faced kids on who work cheap and scream and yell and see how loud they can scream.
If you want to talk to the crew chief that was right there with Alomar, we can get him on the phone here in 3 minutes.
Yeah. Well, we got a lot of stuff going on. We got the umpires walking out, allegedly. They're in court again this morning. We got Jim Leland coming here, which is
terrific.
We can only be ecstatic about that. We got the hockey season starting tomorrow night. We got just all kinds of crap going on. So
beware of exploding balls.
Okay, we'll get Doug MacLean on in a couple of minutes, too, and we'll see what he can add to the mystery of this story. 10:15 at WYOD. Jeff Rimmer, the voice of the Panthers on Sports Channel Florida, which some of us are going to be seeing. See, I don't want to sound selfish, but I don't have any problem because I'm going to get it. I got the big dish. If you folks out there like the big one, a nice big cigar in your puss, and of course people with good taste, everybody once in a while loves to light up and puff on something really great. Mike's Cigars is the place for you. Not just the premier cigar store in this town, but voted one of the top 5 cigar emporiums in the world by Forbes magazine. That's saying a lot, because, you know, everybody and their brother, dime stores and drug stores, mom and pop cigar stores, a lot of places where you can just go and get a cheap cigar. But if you really are a cigar connoisseur, They got over 1,000 different brands of handmade, homemade, premium cigars. Whatever one you like, they got it waiting for you there. And if you don't want to go over to Mike's, which I hope you do to see the amazing joint they got and all the beautiful humidors and accessories, but if you're not close to where they are, which is 1030 King Concourse in Bay Harbor, then they got a beautiful catalog, and they ship out all over the world. They'll send them right to you or to anybody you like who is a cigar lover. In Dade County, call 866-2277, and they'll whip you out an absolutely free brand-new catalog. 866-2277. Toll-free from outside of Dade, it's 1-800-962-4427. 1-800-962-4427 for that new free Mike Cigar catalog. Like I said, if you love great cigars, you're going to love Mike Cigars.
Talkin' Entertainment Radio, 610 WIOD.
Okay, 1019 at WIOD. Here's the man. Here's Doug MacLean.
We don't want you to
get overshadowed now. We got Pat Riley with a slick hair. We got Jim Leland is flying in as we speak from Pittsburgh. We got some big famous names there. We got JJ with even better hair than Pat Riley.
Yeah.
And, all you did was go to the Stanley Cup Finals. We don't want you to get overshadowed now.
Don't worry about that. No, there's some heavy hitters, which is good, you know. It's nice to see them all coming to town, you know.
Exactly, and of course, you kind of put the pressure on them because you're the guy that took a team nobody thought was even going to make the playoffs to the finals, and these guys are making the big, big, big bucks and got the big names, and they got yet to prove anything yet, at least here.
Yeah, they've proven quite a bit, Neil, though. I mean, really, it's like you and radio. I mean, let's not kid ourselves.
Oh, you're putting those guys in my class? Well, I thought you were my friend, Doug.
Well, they're in your money class from what I hear.
Just,
so what Rimmer tells me.
Almost. Now, listen, before we talk a little bit about this weekend, you guys are going up to Philly. You're leaving this afternoon. I know that Eric Lindros always talked about a place that's a favorite of mine in the Philly area, Wawa's, which is like a big, 7-Eleven, but they got great sub sandwiches. You ever hear of Wawa's?
No.
When you're up there, you want to get the guys over to Wawa's.
I usually go to Rocky's. Have you ever heard of that?
Forget about that. Wawa's has got the best sub sandwiches. I'm wondering, maybe somewhere
up there. Maybe Rimmer's going to buy dinner there tonight. It sounds like the type of place he'd buy dinner.
Up there in Philadelphia, maybe you might find some like paste-on balls for this guy. I'm not like permanent ones, but maybe you might find like a little small pair to start with, because I know he can't find any down here.
Who is this? For who?
For Rimmer.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I'm not going to get into that.
Yeah. So how do we look? Because everybody, other than Shepard, we got everybody healthy now?
Yeah, everybody looks good. I think it's going to be a tough weekend, to say the least. But
now, what does that mean?
Well, the home openers always make it a little more interesting. I'm hoping they're going to be a little bit more uptight than we are because it's their home opener. But I think both teams are... I think Philadelphia in particular are going to be a little, what's that word you used before, off?
Yeah.
Us beating them out last year, I think it gives them a little more incentive. But
is Lindros not playing?
I've heard he's not.
Yeah.
That's the word. But, I mean, TSN reported that somebody's telling me he may be out 10 days.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know. But it'll be a tough game. And I like our lineup. We've got a little bit of a different look with Smith in there up front. I've got Dvorak playing with Lowry and Barnes, which is kind of an interesting line in place of Ray. And then I've got Lindsay, Straka, and Smith, which should be a little different look as well,
Yeah.
So I kind of like the look of our team right now. And I think it's going to be a little tougher year because the teams are going to be, everybody says they're going to be gunning for us a little more. I found they gunned for us pretty good last year. But anyway, it'll be fun.
Team's not getting the respect in the media, though.
Who's this, George?
Team's not getting the respect in the media. Everybody's got their preseason forecasts. And, Doug, to be honest with you, the Panthers aren't anywhere near the top. Everybody's expecting other teams in this conference, and particularly in this Atlantic Division, to finish ahead of Florida.
Well, I think that's lots of people are saying that. And I don't know why they wouldn't give us a little bit better look now, but really, who cares? I mean, we just have to go out and play. That's what we have to do. And most teams in the league know that we'll be a tough team to play against. So that's the bottom line. We'll play hard, and we'll, I just have to hope that the kids come along. Warners and Jovanovskis, and even Niedermeyer's got to be a little better this year, and he's got potential. Your boy Straka's got to play, hard every night, or
he'll score over 30
and
goals.
Let's get something straight right now. If I am to sit him out the odd game, don't jump all over me, Neil, right off the bat.
You're already talking about sitting out Marty Straka, and the season hasn't even started yet? Boy, I sure hope the Czechoslovakian interpreters pass that along to him.
Every time I write his name down, I think of you, and I said, is it worth the aggravation? No, I'll just play him.
That's right. Just keep him in there. That's right. Now you're talking.
And speaking of the media.
Now, by the way, yesterday the fans at our luncheon were saying, when are you going on with Neil again and talking hockey? I said, well, I phone him quite regularly for tips, and, that's the bottom line.
Yeah. I figure now that the season's starting, that would probably be a good time.
You still owe him thanks for all that he contributed to you last year.
I thanked him. I mean, how many times do I have to thank the guy?
I think like once a week would be good, just to keep the memory fresh.
Speaking of the media and maybe not giving the Panthers their just due, I understand there was a story in the New York Times yesterday by Joe LaPointe where he talked about the Panthers playing boring hockey and talked about you and being kind of arrogant.
No, he didn't say that. He said I was thin-skinned and cocky.
Okay, well, arrogant and cocky are pretty close.
And I don't, I mean, I know where it all, I mean, last year he wrote a brutal article about us. We all saw that.
Oh, yeah, that was ridiculous.
So, I mean, he's just, it's fine. I mean,
Are you thin-skinned, Doug?
I'm not thin-skinned. I don't think I am. Do you think I am, Neil?
Not in the least. Not when you're compared to Rimmer. That's the one good thing. Always keep Rimmer around close, man. You look like a hard ass him around.
It's something I've got to improve on. There's no doubt about that.
Well, if you quit eating those stale donuts that Tim Horton's making for you up there, you might be ahead of the game.
That's right. So
what about team toughness, Doug? Is this team going to be tough enough?
Oh, will you get off it, Rimmer? I mean, you guys talked about that all last year. I mean, that's what you... I mean, see, Neil, they jump on one little thing and they run with it, you know?
Well, you know that old
You told me you wanted to address that this year.
I thought physically we were the toughest team in the playoffs last year in our conference, but we've got Martin. We sent him down to Greensboro. He'll be up and down. I think he'll help Paul. We don't want Paul Laws fighting that much because he's too good a player now. I mean, Paul's really improved his game, but Paul will still do that for us, and I think that Martin will be up and down all year to help in that area.
And what about your new TV show that debuts tomorrow night at 6 o'clock on Sports Channel?
Well, I heard that, I don't know. Neil, you haven't heard about it, have you?
No, I haven't heard a word about it.
Rimmer's the host.
Yeah.
And, I mean, here we are doing the show the other day, and I've got to try to get him to relax. He was so uptight. Now, he's supposed to be the TV guy.
Yeah.
I mean, it was.
Well, that's because he knew he had made a commitment to come out here this morning, and he knew he could never live up to all the promises he made. So he's been uptight all week. He'll be all right.
Really,
once they drop the puck, he'll be all right. He'll loosen up a little bit. And what about that radio show that I heard about that you might be doing?
Yeah.
Now, do you know anything about that?
Yeah, it was just a little bit of a communication problem there, but it's all, I guess it's all worked out.
You guess?
Yeah, it's going to be, it's going to be fun.
They have a new format over there.
Are you going to be phoning in?
Huh?
Are you going to phone in on
I will be phoning in on your show, as a matter of fact, to keep you honest. That's a good idea every week. That's an excellent idea.
Does this mean it's going to be your last appearance on the Neil Rogers show?
No way.
No chance.
No way.
He wants to talk to somebody who knows something about the game, I think is a good idea.
You're really putting me in the spot,
now,
Roger.
Now, let me ask you something. seriously, have you, I mean, obviously you're playing the Rangers on Sunday, and then we're playing the Rangers more times in the month of October. Last year we didn't play them hardly at all till the end of the season, and now we're loading up on the Rangers in the beginning.
I mean, how strange is that, though?
I don't get the schedule at all. In fact, if you look at the schedule, you know, last year everybody complained how bad it was.
Yeah.
You look at the schedule, and man, there's like the Leafs. I know the Leafs are going to be in last place all year. There's going to be no pressure, but they got a couple of trips where they go and play San Jose, they come back home, then they go back to play Colorado. I mean, whoever put this schedule together must have been on drugs.
Well, I'll tell you, I don't know if the computer did or not, but like what amazes me is last year we played the Rangers five times in the last month,
it seemed,
and this year we've got them four times in the month of October, so it's strange, and I'm not overly fussy about it. I don't like the way we start. You know, because it is a tough schedule. We got 7 of the first 13 against the Rangers in Philly, and then you throw Colorado and Chicago in there. But you got to play them, so let's get on with it.
And what do you think about the Rangers? I mean, there are a lot of people who think that they wasted a ton of money on Gretzky. There are other people who are picking him to go all the way now because they think Messier can have a big year with Gretzky there, and they got, Richter played so great in the World Cup.
Yeah, Richter, Leach, Messier, Gretzky, Graves, Kovalev, they've got a real good team. I think they're going to be strong. I really do. Gretzky, you know, we know, I mean, he's guaranteed 100 points. I think that's what he'll do in the regular season. And, I think Wayne will be able to handle playing with Messier a lot better than people think.
But I got to ask you this about Gretzky, because the Leafs didn't accomplish much in the playoffs last year, but they did set a precedent, and that is they started beating the living snot out of Wayne, who's not used to that. He's used to having guys stand around and watch him and admire his passing and skating ability, and they started really getting to him, and he can't take it. And
I think
after that they did the same thing in the Detroit series. If you start hitting Gretzky, he becomes a different player.
Well, I think it's happened to him over the last couple of years.
Yeah.
And in the playoffs it really picks up, because in playoffs it's all business, you know, and we saw that, the difference in our team in the playoffs compared to the regular season. It's just a it's that extra level, you know, and you do tend to go after people. You just you forget about all the tradition then, and go for it. I don't know if I'm making any sense, am I?
Not really. I think you're doing what you do the best.
You know what I'm doing, to be quite honest? While I was dancing that
putting question, on your skates.
I was tying my skates.
No, I think what you're doing is what you do best, and that's covering all sides, covering your butt, which is a good idea. But who do you like in the division that we have to, who you think we can, the Rangers or the Philadelphia, that we're going to really have to beat out? Because I'll be honest with you, personally, I'll answer my own question first. I think the Flyers had their big chance last year, and I think they just didn't have the intensity that they had the previous year. I think this year they might not be as good.
Geez, I hope you're right. I just, every time I look at Renberg, LeClaire, Lindros, I get nervous. That's all. You know, they can be such a dominant line that they can bury, and that's the only thing that concerns me. You know, I don't know how much Howard Chuck will do as their second line guy, but... I looked for Pittsburgh. They're an interesting group, too. Like, I just don't know what's going to happen with them because Hatcher, now they signed Muni on the blue line. They should be a little better, but I don't know. I don't see anybody that's really improved. Montreal look like an interesting team, to be quite honest.
I don't know about Mario Tremblay as the coach there.
I'm going to give you a little tip on Pittsburgh, even though I know we don't play them until later on, but Pittsburgh, even though they got Kevin Hatcher, defensively, boy, they're worse than ever. I know that comes as a shock, but defensively, they're very suspect, and they got a lot of problems. Smolinski is going to be traded. There's no way he's going to sign with them. Smolinski's going to be gone. Nedved's going to hold out into the season for at least another couple of weeks, maybe more than that. So they got some problems there, even with Mario.
Yeah, I agree. It's going to be interesting, but I don't know. I like the look of our team right now, and I think we can compete with anybody. But,
yeah.
So it'll be interesting. Jersey now, I see Bob McKenzie and TSN is picking Jersey to win the Stanley Cup. So how do you know from year to year what's going to take place?
Is Roenick going to end up in New Jersey?
What?
Roenick?
I thought he just got traded to Phoenix.
Well, I know. He hasn't signed yet either.
He's not going to play for Phoenix. You know that.
No, I don't. I think he will. I think he'll play in Phoenix.
Got any rumors for us you can leave us before you head to the ice?
And no more Brendan Shanahan stories now.
Oh, I'm not telling. Rumors unbelievable. They tell me he's out putting his garbage out the other morning. Mellenby was going by trying to come to president when he was waving him down and giving him a scoop.
Not waving him down.
I believe
he stopped to say hello.
I told Mel next time he goes by, just kick his garbage cans over.
Okay, Coach. Best of luck this weekend.
Thanks a lot.
Bring back at least, well, we'll settle for one out of two this weekend, and then we'll do some real business on Tuesday.
Okay, take care, guys.
Okay, see you, bud. Okay, Doug MacLean giving you the inside story there instead of some of the other BS we hear. It's 10:30 at WIOD. Lorenzo's in North Miami Beach on the corner of 163rd and Dixie Highway. And Ben and Bob's in the Indian Trace Shopping Center in Weston continue the big one. It's going on right now, the 45th anniversary sale. And it's going to continue right to the second annual Italian Heritage Festival coming up November 1 through 3. So right now at Lorenzo's, prime rib veal chops, $8.99 a pound. Leg veal cutlets, $10.99 a pound. Try the Peter Luger steak sauce, the best in the world, I guarantee you, only $4.99. And today and tomorrow, fresh red snapper fillets, only $8.99 a pound. Delicious fresh poached salmon with dill sauce, $10.99 a pound. Imported prosciutto, $6.99 for the half pound. And just arrived at Lorenzo's Pasta Grill, homemade California red wine, the 1.5-liter bottle, only $6.99. Over at Ben and Bob's in Weston, pick up Florida juice oranges, 8 for a buck. Great seafood like oven-ready flounder, $3.99 a pound. Swordfish steaks, only $9.99 a pound. And farm-raised Maine mussels, 99 cents a pound. It's the big one. It's going on right now as I speak. The 45th anniversary sale at Lorenzo's Italian Center in North Miami Beach and at Ben and Bob's Fresh Seafood and Produce in Weston.
Talk and Entertainment Radio, 610 WIOD.
What are you saying? 10:34 at WIOD. Jeff Rivers here. We got a million different things going on. We got the Leland is coming in, which surprised me because I guess here's one guy who thinks money isn't everything, and he probably took a look at that California Angels roster and the dearth of pitching, which they have none, and he said all the money in the world and all the Disney stock in the world isn't worth going out there and at this stage of my life and falling on my ass.
Listen, I got news for you.
At least in coming here, he's coming to a team that even with John Bowles, and you know, a lot of us, including me, made jokes about John Bowles when he took over, and the fact that he looked like he was lost and made a lot of very bizarre decisions and strategy during some early games. But he brought that team along pretty good. They finished only two games under 500, which is a miracle. And Leland's basically taken over the nucleus of a team with some potential.
I talked to Dave Dombrowski the other day, and I kind of said, you know, this setting up an analogy, because Dombrowski was in Montreal, although he came to Montreal after I left and went to Baltimore, Washington. But I said to Dombrowski, it was very much to me personally like when Bulls, similar position guy, Jim Fanning, was with the Montreal Expos, and he came after they fired Dick Williams, came out of the front office to manage the Expos and got them to the league championship series. But Fanning went back into the front office, and they got an everyday manager, and he's now scouting for some team, and it may in fact still be the Montreal Expos because he lives in Montreal. But I don't think without a doubt, and I think it was Gordon Eads who first broke the story in the Sun Sentinel now 8 weeks ago, 2 months ago. If you remember, he said that Leyland could end up managing the Marlins, and it was almost like a fait accompli. And I think that Eads was onto something then, and obviously was correct, because today is going to be unveiled as a new manager. It's a great move. I've been around baseball a long time, and this guy is, without question, heralded as the premier manager in the game.
And you know, they're going to make some moves. That's the one thing that you got to say, whether you like Arison, you like Huizenga, you like any of these guys, is that they have opened up the purse strings now, and especially I think with the Marlins. I think Wayne's got to realize that unless they do something dramatic and drastic now, that there's a good opportunity that this town is going
to
support baseball.
And he's prepared to do it.
Well,
they've
got to give it at least one shot here, because the attendance has dropped so dramatically each year since that opening year, when there was a lot of excitement and a lot of interest as though this was something brand new, and maybe it was to a lot of people here. But it's not there now.
I'm sure that Dombrowski, be it the president, Smiley, and Huizenga himself have told Leyland that he's coming here, and they want to put the pieces of the puzzle together. They've got a great nucleus here. They've got a great 1-2 combination they brought in here last year. Pitching-wise, they've got Gary Sheffield. And those people that suggest that they've got to trade Gary Sheffield, I mean, they couldn't be further from the truth. This guy is the kind of baseball player you build a team around. I think Conine becomes the first baseman next year. They go out, and maybe they get Bonilla. Although Bonilla's now, in my talks to people in Baltimore, Bonilla's now hinting that he'd like to stay with the Orioles. So I don't know if that could happen, but who knows. We've heard the stories, and I don't know if it's possible to get Barry Bonds here, but boy, wouldn't it be great to see Bonds here. He's a great ball player. But I think it's pie in the sky. I don't think it's going to happen. But there are some free agents out there, and obviously the Marlins can make some trades, because they do have some young players in their farm system that can make the Marlins
You really think we need Barry Bonds? Don't you think we've reached our jock asshole quota, our quotient in this town already? We don't need Barry Bonds? I mean, Barry is trouble wherever he goes. There's no question he's got the ability. And Sheffield's got his own problems, but he's not even in the league with Barry Bonds.
But if you remember Leyland, and it's one of the great pieces of video that we've seen on ESPN over the years. It was at Bradenton is where the Pirates trained.
Right.
And I guess Bonds was mouthing off to the media and mouthing off to some of his teammates, and Leyland went right in, and the cameras were on him. And if you remember, he undressed Bonds right there, and it became somewhat of a folk piece for months after that, because on every show you saw Leyland telling Bonds the way it was. And quite frankly, you look at Bonds today, and he says the guy that he's got the most admiration for as a baseball manager is Leyland. So if anybody can control this guy, it's Jim Leyland.
Okay, we'll see. Speaking of baseball, by the way, I think you and I are probably the only two people in the free world who disagree with all this hysteria about the Alomar incident with the spitting. You know, last night in the Dodger-Braves game, they brought up something very interesting. That is that there was a precedent in 1942. Bill Dickey of the Yankees got into an incident with Bill Summers, the late American League umpire,
right.
Bill Summers, and got into a shoving match and shoved him. And Kennesaw Mountain Landis was the commissioner of baseball. And, of course, anybody who knows baseball history knows that he was brought in the 20s after the Black Sox scandal to clean up baseball. I mean, he was the toughest disciplinarian. He was a no-nonsense guy, to say the least. And yet, the suspension he handed out to Dickey for shoving an umpire was 30 games starting during the regular season the following year, not during postseason. There is no precedent in baseball to suspend a player during postseason play.
Donald Fear said that very thing the other night on national television. I'd love to get the American League crew chief on that worked that series, and there's no question in my mind that Hirschbeck provoked Alomar. Alomar is not a hothead. I covered the American League, as you know, for 10 years, and in Alomar's years, obviously they were in Toronto, but this guy is not a hothead, and you cannot see Hirschbeck because his back is to the camera in any of the views that we've seen on television. But this guy was provoked, and as I've said many times before, I've seen umpires time and time again provoke these players, and they're going to snap. I mean, anybody will. You can push them so far, and they're going to go. But Alomar is a classy guy, and I know it was not a class act, but the guy was provoked, and obviously he lost it.
And what bothers me about, you know, Richie Phillips coming out and making this statement, this self-righteous statement last night, is that nobody seems to care about the game itself. In other words, how can they possibly survive You know, we had the shortened season 2 years ago. We didn't have any playoffs, no World Series. We've had all this decrease in fan interest. Now you finally get to the one time of the year when people like me, who don't watch all that much baseball during the regular season, I find myself watching most of these playoff games and certainly going to watch the World Series. So people, you know, there's a natural inclination. People who don't watch a lot of football during the year watch the Super Bowl. People who don't watch a lot of hockey watch the playoffs. And now, in the middle of this, the umpires decide, well, you know, unless we absolutely get our way, we're going to walk the hell out. Even though we got a no-strike clause in our contract that we finally just signed after walking out for 120 days, we got a no-strike deal in it. We're still going to walk out.
And you know what's going to happen?
No, they're going to be worse for the game.
They're going to be in federal court today,
right.
And there'll be a court injunction, and the umpires will go back to work today. There, no question in my mind that the
you
umpires
think they
are
will
not
going
to. Oh, for sure. They're going to have to. They're going to be forced to go back. And they're going to be in court today in Philadelphia, and they'll be. A rule to go back to work, same as it was the other day when I talked to McKean the first time, and he said that, hey, we've got to stand by Hirschbeck and the umpires as a union, a very strong union, but he expected right from day one, had they gone in the initial time before the deal was made for a couple of days, if you remember, they made a deal, he said that there's no question in my mind that we're going to be forced to go back to work, but at least we're going to take our stand, and that's likely what Richie Phillips is doing right now.
And I think if you had a real commissioner instead of Bud Selig, I think you'd see a guy
problem.
A guy come in here and say, okay, look, there's no way that we can suspend anybody during postseason now, but we'll agree to increase the suspension to 15 games or 20 games or whatever the number might be to pacify the umpires, to pacify the public who are up in arms about this and say, listen, we're not going to accept that kind of conduct no matter what incited it. It's unacceptable, it's grotesque, and we're not going to accept it.
Does that crime fit a 20-game suspension in your mind?
Well, not really.
I don't think so.
But I'm going to tell you, you talk to the public and you listen, and after Joe Buck and McCarver went on about this precedent, they then did a complete turnaround to say that what Alomar did was far worse than shoving an umpire. So in other words, spitting in somebody's face in the minds of the public today is much worse than actually physically confronting somebody and shoving them or hitting them. I'm sorry, I don't buy that.
No, I don't buy it either. You made the analogy the other day with regards to Claude Lemieux and what he did to Draper in the playoffs, and he gets two games.
Right.
Two games. He could have ended that player's career.
Could have killed him.
He could have seriously hurt him. No question. Gets two games. And Alomar, and I'm not saying it's right, it's a classless act, but Alomar gets, what, five games? And this guy gets two games and he almost kills somebody?
Yeah.
Forget it.
Okay, 10:43 at WYOD. Jeff Rimmer is here today having a free lunch. Tonight is a big night, folks. Speaking of great meals in the clubhouse dining room, tonight's the return of Pompano Park Racing. That's right. It's the grand opening of the 1996-97 racing season tonight. The festivities will begin at 6 o'clock tonight with a free Oktoberfest in the parking lot. There will be free general admission for everybody tonight, and the first 2,500 fans through the gate will get a special gift from performers from Pure Platinum and LeBear. The racing kicks off with a Broadway singing review and national anthem, followed by the parade of horses, trainers, drivers, and VIPs. Then Pompano Park's veteran track announcer and new general manager, Gary Seibel, will pass the microphone to his new announcer from Scioto Downs. There's a ribbon-cutting ceremony in the new winner's circle, and of course, post-time tonight will be 7:30 with live racing and simulcasting from Dania Highline. You can watch, you can wager, you can win, hopefully, in South Florida's largest simulcasting arena. It's the big one, the grand opening of the 1996 racing season at Pompano Park, just a block south of Atlantic Boulevard on Racetrack and Powerline Roads in Pompano. We'll see you there for sure tonight. Don't forget, free admission for everybody. Post-time, 7:30 at Pompano Harness.
Talk and Entertainment Radio. 610 WIOD.
10:44 at WIOD. A mighty big weekend. Pompano Park opens tonight. Hockey season starts tonight. The Panthers kick off their new season tomorrow night. We got just all kinds of crap going on. Here's a mobile in Fort Lauderdale. Hello.
Hey, Neil.
Yes, sir.
This is Tom. Hey, I wanted to ask you guys a couple of questions. Then I'm going to hang up because I'm on a local line on a mobile. But you touched on a couple of things, one being the concept of a player's manager versus a guy like Jimmy Johnson. And I'm a Pittsburgher. Do you have any comments on the difference between, let's say, a Shula era and a Jimmy Johnson era, and then the Latchman era, and let's hopefully say the Leland era? And the second comment I wanted to ask you guys to, comment on is... what do you think about my Steelers? And I'm going to hang up, and I appreciate it. Have a good Friday, guys.
Okay, pal.
Do you think Jimmy Johnson's a player?
Get that food out of your
mouth. You think Jimmy Johnson's a player's coach?
Of course not.
Well,
no, he's a strict disciplinarian who will put up with no crap. But you know something? And this is sound pretty far afield. But you saw that thing they had on CBC about the history of Toronto and Montreal hockey rivalry.
Right.
And they had that segment on Punch Imlach. Now, for those not hockey fans or not old enough to remember, the Leafs last won the Stanley Cup in 67-68. They won four Stanley Cups in the 60s, all under Punch Imlach, who took a franchise that in the late 50s was floundering and came in and built a dynasty and won four Stanley Cups. Every former player from Frank Mihalovic and Carl Brewer and Ron Ellis and everybody else they had on bitched and bellyached about the fact that Imlach was relentless and he worked him too hard and the guys couldn't stand it and they were psychotic, but he was a winner. Right?
Absolutely.
So,
because he put the fear of God in them. And
yeah.
Obviously, Jimmy Johnson, and, you know, I don't know if you'd want to say that he's not a player's coach. He's a strong disciplinarian, for sure. But if you remember all the accolades that came his way when he first took over the Dolphins, who begged for some discipline. One of the big problems with Don Shula in the latter years there, that the Dolphins were much a country club.
Out of control, yeah.
Exactly.
Definitely out of control.
So they needed that discipline. And then you get a guy like Keith Byers, you say it's sour grapes or whatever, saying that there's a lot of players that don't like Jimmy Johnson. And, I mean, obviously he's put the fear of God in them, but at the same time, he's given them a chance to play, and he wants them to practice hard and play hard, much like Punch Imlach. I mean, that's where I lived.
I'll give you a more current example in hockey, and that's Scotty Bowman. Now, you're always telling me Scotty is crazy and Scotty is senile, and whatever you call him. But the fact is, the players, most of them hate Scotty Bowman. Dino Cicerelli hated him. Primo hates him. A lot of those guys can't stand him. And again, for a lot of the same reasons, because he's a hard disciplinarian. He works him like crazy. He demands perfection. And a lot of guys don't want that.
But
and
Scotty
yet,
plays and mind games. He manipulates people.
Yeah. But granted, but the fact is, okay, they haven't won a Stanley Cup in longer than the Leafs, but they still have great teams. They won 62 games last year. They broke all kinds of records, and they're a winner.
Mention the Penguins, the late Bob Johnson. He won a Stanley Cup with Pittsburgh. Scotty came and inherited the same team. Do you give Scotty the credit or the Penguins the credit when they won those back-to-back cups?
So what you're trying to say is, Brian,
we're a dynasty then.
Well, Jimmy Johnson sure didn't
be in the right place at the right time.
He sure didn't inherit that, although I noticed Shula made that comment to Roy Firestone the other night, which I thought was a very, just a ridiculous comment to make, is that he turned over a super team to Jimmy Johnson. I mean, the team that the Dolphins have right now, especially with Marino injured, there's no resemblance to the team that was playing for Shula last year.
If you remember Jimmy Johnson when he first took over as coach, he said, hey, this is going to be a bit of a building situation. Obviously, last year, and Jimmy Johnson had a different point of view last year, and that might be the only thing I'd like to debate with him. And if you remember when he was on Fox and he was doing his weekly columns in the Herald, I think it was, he said, hey, the Dolphins have got all the tools. They've got what it takes to win a Super Bowl. And obviously he was kind of hedging his bet at that point, putting a little pressure on
Shula.
You
know why he said that.
Well, sure. Sure we do. But the fact of the matter is when he took over, he said it's going to be a bit of a building program here. He got rid of a lot of dead wood. He got rid of players that obviously did not want to practice. And we're seeing some good, young, enthusiastic players. You're going to play it his way or you're not going to play. You're going to be gone.
And what do you know about the Steelers, beside the fact that Mike Tomczak is marginal at best?
Oh, I mean, they really made a mistake letting Neil O'Donnell get away. I like Neil O'Donnell. He was at Maryland when we did the Maryland games at BAL, and he's a pretty competent quarterback now. You can say, well, he's not doing much for the New York Jets, but that's not a very good football team, the New York Jets.
Okay, let's do Miami. Hello. Miami.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Hello?
Yes, I am.
Yeah, how you doing, Neil?
Okay.
How are you?
Great.
I have a few things I want to say. First of all, talking on the first topic of sports, like I said, I was born down here in Miami with the 72 Shula days. And, you know, I've been a sports fan down here. First of all, number one, I feel sports should be the respect, the players should be the respect of, as a healthy sport, not, you know, as a healthy atmosphere of not taking drugs, don't drink. And this is the topic of the Alomar situation. I feel that you know, there shouldn't be no violence in sports. The people getting into sports, especially with the finance that they make, there should be a role model to where there should be
like Michael Irvin and Barry Bonds.
Barry Bonds, the Miami University of Miami players all over the country.
Bobby Cox, Warren Moon.
Right, right, and you know, especially with the violence of fighting, but not spitting in a
Lawrence
person's
Phillips.
Face. Yes.
Yeah.
Not spitting in a person's face that doesn't get the right look of the younger people that...
Yeah, but what that's... Well, I'd like to know, what is it in sports that's going on, with very few exceptions, represents a role model to young people. And I was talking the other day about Alex Rodriguez with Seattle. I said, if young kids want a role model, there's somebody they ought to look up to, okay? No drugs, no problems, no, you know, no public hanky-panky that anybody has to know about. Whatever it is, he just goes out there, gets the job done. He's as squeaky clean as a wheel. And there's a role model for you. But how many others can you name today?
Not too many. I mean, I have so much. I have like a sub plan because I'm on the way to my office. I just want to say a few things.
Okay.
Well, the Marlins have some role models, and I guess the way that stands out the most is Jeff Conine.
Yeah, but the problem with Jeff is he's a hell of a ball player and he's a good guy, but he's boring. People find him boring. And I'll give you another guy.
No personality.
Dale Murphy with the Braves, who was there, had all those great years with the Braves. He was a great player. He was squeaky clean. He used to do milk spots. But I mean, he was too squeaky clean. People considered him boring.
Well, what do you want? Somebody to have an edge?
No, I'm not saying I want. I'm just telling you what I feel is the problem. Why these are not the people that people talk about.
Let's look at our Panthers. I mean, John Van Beesbrook, Rob Niedermeyer. I mean, Scott Mellenby. These are squeaky
clean
guys.
But hockey players, we've already said, the different breed.
Right.
Neil?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Real quick, though, I feel that Alomar should be suspended for the playoffs and about five games next year. But, yes, somebody did a mistake, and he won't do it again. Number two is the coaches are not the team down here. Okay, yes, it's great to have Shula. It's great to have Johnson. Good luck, Jimmy, and everything. But and also that we all come together. We go to the games. The games are on TV. It's great, but it's the money to spend for the players. The players are the team. Not as much as the coaches.
Well, I'll agree to a point. I mean, obviously, people go to games not to see Doug MacLean behind the Panther bench or Jim Leyland in the Marlin dugout, but you need the Jimmy Johnsons, the Leylands, the Pat Rileys, and the Doug MacLeans because they're proven winners.
Right. The discipline of Johnson's great. I don't think we're going anywhere with the Heat. The Marlins, we have a few players away. The Panthers, I wish them luck. I'm not too much of a hockey fan, but I'm going to get into it. And another thing that we... to make it, you know, a long story short, because I got to get going. I hope that the whole country comes together politically. Not to change the subject, but the cemetery in Miami is disgusting what they did. I wish I could secure it myself at the time, 24 hours a day. Let's all come together. Racist goes away, and I have to get going. Thank you, Neil.
Okay, pal.
You're great.
Have a great day. Well, you know, good sentiments, but again, pie in the sky. The country isn't going to come together, and things like that aren't going to stop. And we got a lot of hate mongers and a lot of lunatics.
The world's not
going to
come together.
And they're not going to stop hating each other in the Middle East. But if we lived in a perfect world, hey, it would be great. But he does work in mysterious ways. We have an open line in Dade, 751. We got a pair in Broward, 524-9463. We got a big pair in Broward, which is more than some people can say, 524-9463. Here's South Miami. Hello.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yes. I've never called before. I saw a program focus on South Florida this morning about discrimination in the workplace, and the subject was on bilingual, being bilingual and talking, you know, diverse languages.
Yeah.
My problem is okay, I'm like the average American person. I was born and raised here, just like many other people.
Well, what does that have to do with what we're talking about?
Okay, so what are we talking about? Are we talking about sports, or can we just talk about anything in general?
No, we're talking about sports.
I'm sorry.
We got a guest here who is not bilingual, although he knows a few frogs, but have a great day, pal. What was that? What the hell was that all about? That wasn't a Ron and Ron listener, was it? God, are we moving up in the world. We have an open line in Dade, 751-9463. Jeff Rimer from Quebec, a frog. Well, we might as well tell him you speak French. You know, there was a grotesque
Toronto
story. Last time I was up in Toronto, there was a story in the Sun about a deli, a kosher deli in Montreal, which has primarily, obviously, a Jewish clientele, but others as well. And they have that thing about the signs, about the bilingual signs
right
in the province of Quebec. And to come to find out, this deli, which has been there for like two generations, you know, 50 years, whatever, and the signs in English, as opposed to the French, were too big, bigger than the law allows, permits. And so some of the politicians there made a big stink about it, and they forced them to, like, make the English part of the sign smaller. And now the English-speaking people there are all bent out of shape because they think that they're caving in. And they got this whole big, just over this one poor guy running a delicatessen because the French and the Anglophiles, so-called, up there, hate each other so much.
Well, the language law has been a problem in Montreal since the early
God.
70s. I moved there in 1977, and they had the first referendum shortly thereafter, and the place has gone to hell because, let me tell you, it was one of the great cities in the 60s, and even for Expo 67. Or the 50s and the 60s, even for Expo 67, the World's Fair was there, and it was a great city. But all the major corporations that had their corporate head offices in Montreal all had to move out because of the bilingualism, and Montreal is just a ghost town now.
Just
and,
a ghost town.
And even, a man, you know, we had Dick Irvin on it last hockey season, and I didn't know how he'd respond to it, but, boy, he sure didn't back away from it. Even in the hockey team, on the Montreal Canadiens, boy, if you got a captain on that team who's not a French frog, you got problems. And that's the way they're operating that team. It's the French speakers against the English, which is really pathetic.
And now they've got a French-speaking team captain who they're trying to trade. You don't want to be captain of the Montreal Canadiens.
Exactly.
Bergeron is the guy they're trying to get rid of right now. They say, at least Mario Tremblay, and that's where his problem is. My apologies to Doug MacLean, who says get off the coaches. But let me tell you that Tremblay does not like Turgeon, and Turgeon is being shopped around.
And maybe today you'll tell us the real story about Stefan Richer, but I doubt it. Maybe or the Brendan Shanahan. 1056 at WIOD. Kendall Toyota, the biggest, the best in the world, baby. If you want a great Toyota, this is the place. They've sold over 135,000 new cars, and they're still going strong. Go in there and see why for yourself. Is it the great service? Is it the fantastic selection? Is it the one price selling with the lowest price in the world right there on the windshield, so no pressure, no hijinks, no games, just great deals all the way around? It's probably a combination of all of the above. And the good news for you right now is that all the new 97 Toyotas are in there right now. Brand new 97 Camrys, 97 Corollas, 97 4Runners, RAV4s. They got them all at unbeatable prices. So no matter what anybody else tells you, I guarantee you, Kendall Toyota will give you the lowest price and the best deal all the way around on that new Toyota of your choice. Kendall Toyota, they're easy to find right there on US 1, just south of Dadeland.
Talk in Entertainment Radio, 610 WIOD, Miami, Fort Lauderdale.
Okay, 1058 at WIOD. Rima is with us today. The Panthers are leaving, what, about 2:30 you guys are leaving?
2:30 this afternoon. The guys will be listening on their way, I can assure you of that.
Okay, so probably between 2:30 and 3, Rick and Suds will tell that Brendan Shanahan story. Okay, here's a mobile in Lake Worth. Hello.
Hey, Neil.
Yes, sir.
How's it going?
Great.
Hey, great show, Jeff.
Thank you.
Listen, Jeff, I've listened to you on TV and seen you, and I've listened to you on Neil's show a lot, and I've flipped over to QAM a couple times, and not to rehash any of this, but I think you got a lot more class than the fat humpster. I really do. And that's my opinion. I think he just verbally attacks you. I don't know for what reason, and I really don't want to get into that, but I do think you have a lot more class than him. And
thanks
I like
for
it.
Your comment.
Excuse me?
I said thank you for your comment.
Okay, you got any tickets or hats?
No.
Just kidding. Neil?
Yeah, you're not kidding. You're not kidding. You're not fooling me.
Hey, Neil, I'm really PO'd. I called that woman yesterday.
Yes.
And I left
Cheryl Blanchett?
Yeah, I got the number that you gave out, and I called because, unfortunately, I'm under the cable strains there.
Under the TCI spell, yeah.
Yeah. And unfortunately, I can't just run out and go get a dish right at this moment.
Right.
I'm, you know, got a lot of financial things going on. But I am going to get one sooner or later.
Well, just get your neighbors to call TCI as you do.
I get everybody too, Jeff. And I'm sure Neil got a lot of people too yesterday. I think it's just totally ridiculous. I think it's a bunch of crap. I mean, I don't need to watch the Food Channel. I don't need to watch the Haitian station. I want to watch some hockey. I mean, these guys are the Stanley Cup, man. I mean,
well, I guess Neil yesterday hit some... some pressure points because he got a phone call, as you alluded to earlier,
from
Denver.
Yeah, they got a phone call. Pete Bolger got a phone call over there from the Cheryl Blanchett, I guess is where the call came. And the fact that they would call and complain indicates a hell of a lot of people must have been calling.
But listen to this. Forget all the political bullcrap that's going on about sunshine and
We can forget it, but they're not going to. That's
the
problem.
But what about, you know, it's like it's a slap in the face to the customer. And unfortunately, I can't go out and ceremonially cut the cable today. I can't do that financially at this point in time.
Yeah.
So I am under, you know, their duress, you know. I mean,
but you know something? They're only forestalling the obvious because the Marlins are going to be on there. The Panthers got 65 games this season going to be on there. The Jimmy Johnson show, the Marino show, all these shows are going to be on there. The Doug MacLean show.
Two NFL shows.
All the stuff here is going to be on Sports Channel Florida. So they're only postponing the inevitable TCI. Sooner or later, and hopefully sooner, they're going to have to cave in and put it on there because it's going to have too much stuff on there that the public wants to see.
And it's going to take more than just the sports fans or the hockey fan or the baseball fan. It's going to take collectively all the people that are on that system to let them know, because right now they're bragging that only 10% of their subscribers are calling in and complaining.
That's crap. And another thing, Neil, like you said, and I can't even see the Jimmy Johnson show or the other shows that are on there. I mean, this is South Florida. I can understand if it's a station up in New York trying to beam down to here and want to show us the Rangers or the Jets. That's a different story. This is hometown. and it's just crap, and I'm, well, I guess I'm pissed.
Keep pushing the calls, man.
Hey, Jeff, sorry I won't be able to see you tomorrow night, but good luck and have a good one.
Well, we're looking forward to the season, and hopefully sooner than later, as Neil says, they cave in and they give the people what they want here in South Florida, and that is Sports Channel Florida.
Here's a lady in Miami. Hello.
Well, my point is totally gone now because fortunately you stopped talking about the umpires and the baseball and everything else.
We haven't stopped talking
about any of it. We're talking about whatever you want to talk about. Except for bilingualism.
I'm just so tired hearing about these umpires who basically are really trying to kill the game. They're trying to show that they're more powerful than baseball. And that really ticks me off.
I don't think they're trying to show that they're more powerful than baseball. What they're trying to do is make a statement on behalf of John Hirschbeck. They're trying to stay together, and they know, bottom line, as I said here in the last 15 minutes, they know, bottom line, they're going to go into court in Philadelphia, and the judge is going to rule them back to work. It's going to happen later today.
But what kind of officiating are you going to have with umpires who are that ticked off?
Well, they're going to do their job.
Well, I'm going to tell you something. The umpires have got a lot of problems. And when John McSherry keeled over and died from a heart attack on opening day in Cincinnati, that did was just reinforce the fact, which we've known for years but nobody ever talked about, that a lot of these guys are out of shape. Eric Gregg went up there to Duke University on a rice diet, lost 60 pounds. I don't know where he lost it because he was behind a plate last night in the Atlanta Dodger game, and he still stinks the joint out. He's still bigger than a house, out of shape, and his officiating is horrendous.
How much money do they make?
They make good money.
They do?
Yes, they do.
I mean, because are they... Because I think, you know, to me it seems like they're irritated with the fact that they're not making as much money as the players. Mm-hmm. I've seen a lot of lousy calls in the past year, not just in baseball.
We saw a couple in the Dodger game last night, some bad calls.
Terrible.
The bottom of the ninth inning. I mean...
I'm a Dodger fan, and I was very, very angry.
it's a situation, though, that bothers me about the officials, and they're going to make mistakes, be it hockey, football. We saw a big mistake in the Monday night football game.
What about the Jets game?
Oh, well, that's just what I'm talking about.
Horrendous.
Unconscionable. Unconscionable mistake. And then for them to come out 2 days later and say, well, we made a mistake, doesn't mean a hill of beans.
I mean, I have a suggestion, but no one will listen to it because I'm a woman. But if they would say to the coaches, okay, you have three times that you can say, I want the game stopped, and I want that look.
Well, they did that during the preseason, but unfortunately they're not doing it during the regular season, and it makes a mockery out of the game, and you have games. You had that one game decided by an official's mistake, and you're going to have more of those before the season is over.
And it stinks. It stinks.
I mean, when you're going to pay that kind of money to go out and support a team, to watch your team play, and then they're going to wind up losing a game based on somebody's bonehead call or the fact that nobody's got the balls to make the right call, which in that case they had a conference that went on long after the fact was over, it's very disheartening. What's the point?
Yeah, and then did you see that other game? I can't remember which game it was, where the official was standing in the way and the ball hit him on the head.
Well, maybe that was an omen. Have a great day, then.
Again, I, we're all human beings. We will all make mistakes. But what bothers me is, and especially in baseball, is this provoking by officials and umpires. And in the case of Hirschbeck, again, Roberto Alomar, is a class act. What he did was classless. But obviously he was provoked, and if you look at the video,
you don't have to worry about looking at the video because any, especially Channel 7, just turn it on there for 5 minutes, and even if they're talking about the war in the Middle East or whatever the topic is, no, seriously, they have shown that 50,000 times in the last 24 hours, just over and over and over again. And, of course, the more that they show it, the more it incites the public, and the more you see the actual act of spitting in somebody's face, the more it aggravates. Well, that's disgusting. And you know, people are basically almost unanimously on the side of the umpires, except for the fact they don't believe they should walk out.
No, and I would think at this point that despite going to court today, that the umpires will be on the field tonight. I hope.
Here's Coconut Grove. Hello.
Hello.
Yes.
Neil,
mm-hmm.
First time caller.
Great.
Like your show, except when you get into this sports talk business.
Yeah.
And I feel like it's going to be time to tune you out until after the hockey season.
Yeah.
You know, you tell us when we call up that we can talk about what we want to, you know, you lament about the fact that we don't call all the time.
Let me ask you something. Let me ask you this.
Go ahead.
How many guests do I have on this show? How often do I have a guest on the show?
I appreciate that.
Yeah.
I appreciate the fact that Rimmer's on and you want to talk to Rimmer and you guys are doing sports talk.
For 2 hours, yeah.
Well,
if you want to talk about something else, why can't we do it between noon and 2?
Well, I mean, a guy called just a few minutes ago wanted to talk about something else.
And you know something? If Rimmer weren't here, I still wouldn't. Is this the kind of show I would discuss bilingualism?
Well, no. But
maybe you're being syndicated in Montreal.
Yeah. Yeah, maybe I'm up there with the frogs.
Well,
Parlez-vous douchebag.
No.
So, in other words, you're just calling to complain again. You have nothing to contribute. You're just calling to complain.
Well, no, I would have something to contribute, but all you want to do is talk about sports talk, and I think that it validates a position that I have to tell you that I don't particularly care to listen to the Neil Rogers show when it's nothing but sports talk.
Yeah.
If I want to listen to sports talk, this QAM. I mean, there's other places to go.
I got news for you. If you want to hear a bunch of pimply-faced kids talking about what they think they know about sports, that's QAM for the most part.
Okay.
So go.
Well, I'm just giving you my opinion.
I'll give you some time. Go out. Maybe you can find Andrew's ass in the woods. Good luck, pal.
Take care.
Get out of here. Two open lines and Dade 751. Boy, that last cigar, killer. Rimmer may have to take over the show. May have to cancel the broadcast. Two open lines and Dade 751 WIOD. We have an open line in Broward 524-9463. Here's West Palm Beach. Hello,
Neil.
Yes, sir.
Jeff, how you doing?
Okay.
First off, Jeff, you have total class not to have to Neil. Stoop down to Hank's level.
Thank you.
I have more respect for you by whatever by what you don't do than whatever you could do. Second off, did you see the Dodgers?
Go ahead.
No, I think the plate umpire has way too much power. I mean, I didn't watch the game last night. I was watching the overtime. They replayed the overtime Panthers game last night.
Yeah.
And I flashed back just to see what the score was, and I saw one pitch in the Dodgers game that wasn't even close to the plate, and he called.
I know exactly the one you're talking about. It was about 2 feet outside, not just a foot outside.
Exactly.
Eric Gregg called a pitch a strike that you couldn't hit with two bed slats tied together. And I'll say you can't be right on every pitch, but when you're so wrong, I mean, when you've been trained for this, when you've been doing it for years, and yet when the quality of your work is so inconsistent and so slipshod, it makes a joke out of the game.
Exactly. So I've been to two Marlins games in my life.
In fact, I'll tell you who it was. It was Ryan Klesko, because I remember him walking away and getting up in Greg's face for a second and then walking away, figuring he don't need to get suspended either.
Right.
It was unbelievable.
That just kind of typified baseball for me when I saw that and said that umpire has that much power that he just, in a game of this importance and that close to score, he called him, that's crazy. But, I don't know, just watching the Panthers replay last night gave me goosebumps after, being there, and it's about the third time I've seen it, but that was some kind of game.
Kind of whets your appetite for the start of the season.
Oh, I've got the midst of opening night. I've got to work. We've got we run hockey leagues up here, so I won't be able to go, but I'm dying. I can't wait to get back. I just hope they haven't put too much pressure on Jovanovski's shoulders. Every time I open up the paper, it's got a full-page picture of him on the front. The guy's only, 20 years old?
Well, good for Jovanovski, and maybe bad for Jovanovski is that he is the guy that when you talk about the Florida Panthers, aside from John Van Beesbrook, people start talking about. And this is going to be his second year. He's obviously got a lot to learn. He says it himself. And this is going to be a more difficult year for Jovanovski because not unlike the entire team, more is going to be expected of him, and the opposition is going to be gunning for him a little more than they were last year.
Kind of reminds me of Marino a bit when Marino took him to the Super Bowl right after he got there. And all of a sudden, we're going every year. And then what happened? I mean, I hope to God it doesn't happen.
Expectations are going to be high, exceedingly
right.
High.
I just don't hope that, he's young. I hope it doesn't affect him mentally.
He'll be fine.
Yeah. Okay, Neil. Hey, great show, Neil. Talk as much sports as you want. Screw the other guys.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Bye.
Yeah, don't worry about these other guys. They're listening, and they just called, why are you talking about this? And then, of course, if we weren't talking about this, and you brought up 75 other things, which I do most mornings, they don't call anyway. So what difference does it make?
I got news for you. This story, and you talk about Channel 7 and over and over and over again showing the video, this story transcends sports. And on every news show in every market, all they've talked about is the umpire situation. It's been the lead story. It was lead story last night.
Yeah.
On the major news right across the country.
And especially we get, Jim Leland, one of the most popular and most loved managers in baseball in a long time, he's coming here. He's not going to Boston. He's not going to California or Chicago. He's coming here.
And that's great.
I mean, there are a lot of really profound things going on today. The umpires are threatening to walk out again this afternoon. So this is what's going on, okay? If you can find something else going on here, we find a few bodies in the street, I'd love to hear what it is. And as far as bilingualism is concerned, parlez-vous your rectum. Here's Hollywood. Hello.
Hi, Neil.
Yes, sir.
Listen, I have to agree with your second last caller. Your show stinks today.
Yeah. So why are you still listening?
Well... Bob, because I like listening to you.
Oh,
in
other words, even if the show stinks, you'll still be listening. So what difference does it make?
I will, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, no, I probably will tune you off. You know why?
Yeah, after you're done hearing the sound of your own voice, you'll turn me off. Blow it out your ass, idiot. Probably another one of Hank's boyfriends. Open line in Dade, 751-9463, 751.
Rectum.
And an open line on the Broward line, 524. He wouldn't know Andrew's ass in the woods if he found it. Here's a sunrise. Hello.
Hey, how's it going?
Okay.
Our river's on only once every couple months.
Yeah.
We got a relish this time we're spending together.
That's right.
I tune in
every
time.
Make it quality time.
Okay, listen, to this baseball thing, if it was at the first game of the season he did this, how long do you think it would be before the appeals process went through and all that and his sentence was handed down?
Well, number one, he's dropped his appeal.
Right.
And the only reason these guys, it's happened all the time that these players are suspended. The only reason why he appealed and any other player appeals is to delay the suspension for a convenient time.
Right.
But there is a precedent, and that is if players are going to be suspended, it's for regular season play.
Oh.
But we've seen so many times a base brawl, if you will, and the player will appeal his suspension, and then all of a sudden he'll have pitched in the previous game or hit a home run in the previous game, and all of a sudden he's dropping his appeal and beginning his suspension immediately. But there's no precedent for suspensions to take place during the playoffs, during the postseason, and it wasn't going to happen in this case, and the umpires know it. But again, to rally around Hirschbeck, they're making a statement.
So is that like an actual rule in the book that suspension is only during regular season?
There's no precedent for suspensions in the postseason.
All right. All right. Well, I think he should sit his time out.
When?
Right now.
Oh, you'd like him to sit out now?
Yeah.
You thought it was pretty rude and crude.
No, but there, well...
What about being provoked? Look at it from his side.
Okay, a lot of people are provoked and they spend time in jail for it, you know? Like,
let me ask you this. How many guys have you ever known to spend time in jail for spitting on someone?
Well, I'm talking about another case. It's like guys provoked out in the street and they...
Yeah, but we're not talking about Roberto Alomar pulling out a gun.
We're talking about in any sporting event where there's a level of intensity like there is in baseball or hockey or football, where that's that level of intensity and where there's a major disagreement and tempers flare... And granted, you don't see this very often, thank goodness.
How long have you been watching baseball?
But wait a minute. But we're talking about the potential for somebody doing something in the heat of... he didn't take out a knife and slit his neck.
Right.
He didn't hit him in the... He didn't punch him in the face. And like Jeff says, how do you know what happened to provoke him? And nobody seems to care about that.
Yeah, well, I can understand a guy
How far do you push somebody before you expect them to respond or you expect they might respond? And especially when you know he can't hit him, he can't punch him,
right.
He can't push him, he can't shove him.
Right.
What else was he going to do if he was provoked to that point?
Okay, his team got in on the last game of the season, wasn't it?
Yeah, and he hit the home run that won the game.
Right. So
Saturday, was last Saturday. Right.
Every game during the season was just as important as these playoff games. How do they differ? Just because they're playing for the World Series, each game was just as important to them because they got in on the very last game.
Well, that's ridiculous. I mean, that's a technicality. Once you get to the postseason, you can't, especially in a short series, in a 3 out of 5, you can't say every game during the regular season is important.
Well, let me ask you this question. How long have you followed baseball?
Ever since the Blue Jays went into Toronto, cause that's where I'm from.
Oh, you're from Toronto?
Yeah.
All right. How many times...
God Ty Domi don't ever haul off and kick some ass. Thank God.
How many times did you see a manager, and I'm thinking in terms of Earl Weaver in Baltimore, Billy Martin in Texas or New York with the Yankees, kick dirt in the umpire's face, rush an umpire, bump an umpire.
Farmers.
Pardon me?
Those guys kick so much dirt, they should be called farmers.
All right. Well, wouldn't you think that some of those actions were just as bad as Roberto Alomar's? And I'm not condoning what he did, but he snapped and was provoked.
Well, I think one is a little more disgusting than the other, and, you know, I think dirt kicking was allowed because I think that's as far as they should go.
Seen one of Earl Weaver's tirades in Baltimore when he was managing the Orioles before being enshrined in the Hall of Fame this last August. Some of the stuff that he did was not very classy either.
Okay, with all this hoopla, maybe they should put something in the rule books to set it straight from now on.
That's a good idea.
End it once and for all.
And maybe we could use a real commissioner, too, so we don't have to go through this.
That's the biggest problem with baseball.
Okay, pal.
All right, take care,
Leafs, guys. Go.
Bye.
We have an open line in Broward. In fact, that's going to be our slogan in Toronto this year. Go Leafs, go. We'll pack you a sandwich. It's 11:16 at WIOD. Yeah, don't go too far. Go in Hamilton would be good. We'll come and visit you once in a while.
They had a sellout in Hamilton. You know that. And they were
the
all
Leafs
Leafs
always have a sellout. You saw on that special they did the other night. Who was it? Was it Sittler who said there was not any other city anywhere that could have had Harold Ballard and so many nightmares for so many years and still sold out every night?
They love their Leafs.
Yes, we do. Attention, South Florida, if your expensive air conditioning repair estimate has you hot under the collar, have no fear. You can do it yourself with the expert guidance of Atlantic Air Conditioning Supply. You'll save 50, 60, even 70% off of the cost of air conditioning repair companies. A typical $2,000 air conditioning replacement can be done for as little as $600 if you do it yourself. A $300 repair you can do for under $100. Call 733-5636 for Atlantic Air Conditioning Supply. Let their do-it-yourself center's experienced staff take you through every step from minor repairs to equipment replacement. You'll be amazed at how simple most jobs really are. Do it yourself with Atlantic Supply's help. You're going to save yourself a ton of money. They've got everything you need to get you cooling right away. Now with two locations, they're in Pompano Beach and in Lauderdale Lakes. Call them today at 733-5636 and do it yourself with the expert guidance of Atlantic Air Conditioning Supply. Call them now at 733-5636.
Talk and Entertainment Radio. 610 WIOD.
Oh, my God. If you play Hank Goldberg again, I'm going to fucking throw up.
Okay, it's 1119 at WIOD. Here's a lady in Miami. Hello.
Good morning, gentlemen.
Yes, ma'am.
Some of these people that call that don't like hockey, all they have to do is go to one hockey game and they'll fall in love with it.
No, they weren't saying they don't like hockey. They don't like sports, period. What they do like, we don't know, but they definitely don't like whatever we're talking about.
But I listen to your show all the time, and you talk about baseball, football, whatever. You know, whatever you listen, you're going to gain some knowledge from something.
See, on this show, I talk about whatever is going on. And right now, we got hockey season starts tonight. The baseball playoffs are going on right now. We got a new manager in Miami on a plane coming here right now. We got all the umpires walking out. I mean, what else is going on that anybody else is talking about? Are we going to talk about Yasser Arafat and Bibi Netanyahu and about how there may be peace in the Middle East if we live another 10,000 years, but we doubt it?
Right, right.
Bilingualism.
That's Monday we'll do that. We'll bring in Sandy Payton.
Okay, Mr. Rimmer?
Yes.
Don't stoop down to anybody else's level, you know? You're doing great. Great to hear you back again. I like your broadcast. I just want to hear you when we make one of those great goals. You have to come up with some lines, some new lines.
A la Mike Lang, huh?
This is great.
Like jumping jelly beans?
Yeah.
Put a little spice in it.
Yeah, jumping Jehoshaphat. All right.
Okay, listen. I went on one of those Kathy cruises.
Stupendous. Now you're talking.
I went on one of those Kathy cruises. Unfortunately, I had a late sitting for dinner, and after the waiters finished dancing with the dessert, the World Cup was on, so I run down to the main floor. There's a cruise, like over 2,000 people. I go, the TV, the big screen TV they have on, there's two people sitting there watching the hockey game.
Yeah.
I start talking with them. They're from Detroit, Michigan, and we start talking about the Panthers and the Red Wings and so on and so on. So about 15 minutes after talking, the wife leans over. She says to me, her two brothers play in the National Hockey League. I said, what? His two brothers? So it was Hatcher. Gary Hatcher was his name.
Huh. Mark Hatcher.
Mark Hatcher?
That's what his name was,
oh,
yeah.
Oh, Mark. When that guy stood up, he is big as his brothers are.
Yeah. Mark's bigger.
Mark, okay.
Mark played in Baltimore in the American Hockey League.
That's what he told
me. And is bigger than Kevin and Darian. And I understand now he's about 300 pounds.
Right. He's a big guy.
Yeah.
So that was
Mr. Hatcher to you.
Pardon?
Mr. Hatcher to you.
Mr. Hatcher, right? So that was a real neat thing to meet somebody there like that. So, but we were the only ones with 2,000 people watching the hockey game there.
That's great.
Yeah. So go Panthers, and thanks a lot.
Okay, have a great day.
Take care. Bye.
Yeah, we sure don't want no violence in hockey, I'll tell you.
Here is Brindamore for Quinn on a half court. Balloon kept in front. Brindamore with the puck. 28 seconds left in the power play. And the Flyer unable to get it to the point. Here's a break. Lindsay away from Svoboda. Lindsay scores!
Bow Wow Pete Cow Kick. See, if he just would have said Bow Wow Pete Cow Kick, it'd be more memorable.
You know, Rachel Alexander's now in Washington,
yeah.
A hockey beat writer for the Washington Post.
Yeah. Isn't that a frightening story about journalism in America? Here's the same woman that was talking about Doug MacLean getting petition signed in Summerside in PEI by Tim Horton, who owns the local donut shop. Tim Horton, who used to play for the Leafs and the Sabres, has been dead for over 20 years. has the biggest, his wife owns the biggest chain of donut shops all over Canada, Tim Hortons Donuts. And she just, you know, it goes to show you, getting a little bit of information is dangerous when you have no idea what you're talking about.
I went to...
I'm surprised she didn't get a job on QAM.
I went to Summerside PEI, obviously with the Panther training camp, and I went to that Tim Hortons Donuts, and I was looking for Tim, but, hey, after an hour, I kind of got the hint he wasn't going to show up.
How about Foster Hewitt? He might have been there. Here's Hollywood. Hello.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Hey, how you doing today?
Okay, sir.
Hello to Neil and hello to Rimmer.
Ben, hello. Hello to you.
All right. Two things I want to touch on basically with baseball. I played baseball all my life, and I was in the minor leagues for a while. And
how high up did you get?
St. Lucie Mets. Played for a couple of years and dropped out, had a family and that. And But you know what's really disheartening about baseball today is last year I went to the last game of the season. Took my four kids, and that's my fault. But they wouldn't even look at you in the bullpen. They wouldn't even look at you and give you an autograph or anything else. That's really disheartening for the kids and everything else, you know.
And, this was last year?
Last year, and I took them to the last game this year, too. And same thing. It was like, you know, I changed my attitude again. I said, well, the kids are going to take them and everything else. And I don't think they have any sense that the kids are more important than especially in the last game of the year.
Without a doubt. And you know what? I thought that
and
baseball...
I think it needs to be addressed. You know?
I thought baseball made a concerted effort last year after the long lockout and the strike and baseball. And the guy probably that exemplified the way baseball players should be is Cal Ripken. I hate to talk about a guy that I was around for 10 years in Baltimore. But the fact of the matter is, if you remember, while he was still chasing Lou Gehrig's record for consecutive games, which he's now surpassed,
right,
he went out of his way to spend a half an hour either before batting practice or after batting practice in every city that he went to.
Absolutely.
To sign autographs.
Absolutely.
And baseball, the Players Association even said, we've got to get back to the grassroots. We've got to let the fans know that we've got nothing but time for them. And that's kind of disheartening
to
believe.
When you take four kids to a ball game, you know, I make 40 a year or whatever, but that's besides the point. When you take a kid to a game or whatever, it's disheartening. If I got to go there, I'm going to spend $100 easy. You know what I'm saying? And when they can't even get the respect.
Yeah, you make a good point. It's a very good point that now, just to get into the ball game, the average person can't afford to go very often, and certainly not to take a family.
Playing, you know?
Right, that's right. And then to top it off, adding insult to injury, if you want somebody's autograph, well, come and see me at the card show, and I'll for $75, I'll give you an autograph.
You know,
what kind of crap is that?
When I played semi-pro ball, I mean, you know, I went out of my way to, and I was nobody, you know what I'm saying? But that's not the point. The thing is, you were there, and they made a point of it then. Even in St. Lucie Mets, they made a point of it to please the fans and everything else.
Yeah.
But I don't see that. I don't see that. I think that's really hurting the whole thing, you know. It don't dishearten me. It just disheartens the kids, and that's what really gets me.
Amen.
And how you doing today?
Great.
Great. How's Neil doing?
Great.
You still smoking that stogie?
Still puffing on it.
All right, I got to come down and pick that tool up. I'll see you in a little while. Is there any way I can get your autograph and his autograph and a bumper sticker maybe?
Sure, whatever you want.
All right, I got to come down a little while. My name is Marty, all right?
Okay, $50.
Hey. No problem. You take me to lunch.
Okay, Marty.
All right.
See you later.
Talk. Bye.
Why not?
I could never charge for an autograph. I'm Rick Weaver, and that's my opinion for News Talk Radio 610 WIOD.
But, Rick, who'd want it? Okay, we have an open line in Broward, 524-9463.
Pay for an autograph.
We got a cart for everything, okay? We got something, and wait till you see the new setup we're going to have.
How are you going to get all these carts carted over? And obviously, they'll all be on computer, right?
Right.
That'll be awesome.
It'll be a project, but everything's going to be in the, you won't believe it, the stuff we're going to be able to do. In fact, one of the things we discovered in that 360, which is a little machine that's got all the buttons on it for all the quick drop-ins, we've got the various gun sounds, which I thought would be appropriate for my Bob Green tribute on Tuesday or Wednesday, whatever is our first day in that studio.
Are you doing a tribute, are you?
Huh? Oh, yeah. And it starts out, of course, with the sound of the gun cocking, and then... And, of course, there's an unlimited number of... You can do it, like, a variety of ways. So, anyway, it's 1127 at W... They won't take it personal, of course. At WYOD, there's some realities in today's world that need to be addressed, like the safety of you and your family. That's why Liquid Bullet is a product you should know about. Liquid Bullet's a small, state-of-the-art defense weapon that uses a high-powered chemical stream that is 80 times more powerful than mace, but it's still safe to keep in a house with children. So while it's effective as a gun, it's lots safer, trust me. Liquid Bullet reaches up to a 20-foot circle of defense. It leaves your attacker helpless for up to 20 minutes, but there are no after effects. The Liquid Bullet can be concealed in the palm of your hand, attached to your key ring. They have car units, home units, too. Liquid Bullet can even work on vicious animals. So, and also, don't forget, you get a free lifetime refill. So when you're ready for state-of-the-art protection for you and your family, check this out, Liquid Bullet. For more information about how to find Liquid Bullet, or if you'd like to order it with your credit card, just call that number, 1-888-L-BULLET. That's 1-888-L-B-U-L-L-E-T. Dealers and distributors, welcome to call.
Talkin' Entertainment Radio. 610 WIOD.
Okay, we don't like what you're doing today. We're going to turn it off pretty soon, okay? Just keep saying that, man. You couldn't turn this show off if somebody held a gun to your puss. It's 11:31 at WIOD. Or spit in your puss, exactly. Or called you a douchebag. Here's West Palm Beach. Hello.
Yeah, Neil.
Yes, sir.
Hey, listen, did you hear the humster last night?
No, I don't listen to the humster.
He made an attack on Rimmer.
Oh, that's unusual, yeah.
Can I have it on tape. Can I play it for you?
Why bother?
Well, I thought you might be interested.
What does he say?
I'll play it.
Yeah, sounds good. Okay, we have an open line today. It's 751, one on the green line, 1-800. What did he say? Oh, yeah, that's not new for him. Here's Hialeah. Hello.
Hey, how you doing, Neil?
Okay, sir.
First, I want to thank the Lord that hockey season starts tonight.
Oh!
It's been 3 months too long.
Yep.
Second thing I wanted to comment on was about my cable company. And I understood earlier in the week somebody said to me that you were publicly broadcasting the phone number for the direct line to CCI cable.
Yes, sir.
Colorado. Can you give it to me again, please?
Okay, the best number in Denver is it's area code 303 267-5500. And the guy to talk to, his name is Jed Palmer.
Okay.
Yeah.
But
if people want to call Cheryl Blanchett at the local, which is probably a waste of time, it's 954. It's a Broward number, 723. Well, I'm just giving this out for anybody else.
Oh, no problem.
954-723-7138.
Yeah,
and
it
I don't
is
care
a big waste of time because I've called up numerous times, and so has my boss. We all have TCI, and they really stink.
Yeah.
Well,
it's not. See, they want you to think that it's a waste of time. Maybe calling locally it will be, but if you keep calling their corporate headquarters out there in Denver, it is not going to be a waste of time if enough people call and keep calling and drive them up the wall. Because if you just sit back and wait, who knows if you're ever going to get it.
They're delaying the inevitable, and the more people that call and talk to them at the corporate office, I think the more they'll get the message that it's not just Panther hockey fans, but everybody wants TCI to pick up Sports Channel. There's all kinds of programming in addition to the hockey program.
The UM games.
Exactly. It includes the Panther games, the Doug MacLean show. There's the NFL show, the Jimmy Johnson show. There's a pregame show.
You can be sure there'll be a Jim
Monday
Leland
night.
Show.
Hey, which show?
Jim Leland show.
Oh, there'll be a Jim Leland show.
Once we get
to
baseball season,
no
you'll be
question.
Sure of that.
Yeah.
Done deal.
Also, when you commented on Timmy Horton's donuts, when I was up in Edmonton a few months ago, I tell you what, I kept looking for Timmy too, but he didn't show up.
A lot of people have been waiting for him.
Yeah.
Carl Brewer said he's waiting to reunite with him, but it's a long way.
One day we got to bring in the Ouija board. Maybe we can bring Timmy back.
Thanks a lot, Neil. You have a great day, guys.
And back to you.
Bye-bye.
Yeah, with our luck, Harold Ballard show up. We have two open lines in Dave.
I love
Harold
Ballard.
Huh?
I love Harold. You would have liked this guy. You would have hey, listen to me. I know he screwed up the Leafs, but what a great guest on a talk show. When the Leafs in Montreal, and this is when I was living.
We got the assholes for freedom. The assholes for fun. The assholes for Jesus. The assholes for guns. Assholes for justice. Assholes for crime, assholes for assholes, assholes for all time. We got assholes making money, they're making all the rules, taking all our jobs, and they're filling up our schools. Assholes on the water, assholes in the sky. Won't you tell me, have I really made the grade? Am I held my class, or am I just another asshole on the grade?
Nails, God.
Assholes give the orders, and assholes row the boat. Assholes get elected, cause assholes get to vote.
Wreck 'em.
I once heard it said that old assholes never die. They just lay in bed and multiply. Assholes in the morning, assholes every night. Assholes to the left and the race. There's 20,000
assholes in an asshole promenade. Step aside, good people, it's assholes on the race. All right, 104 WYD. Thanks, Rimmer. It was okay in my book, and there we go. They're off to Philadelphia. Team will be on the way at 2:30 flight. They're going to kick the Flyers' ass tomorrow night. And who knows, might even wind up with a sweep opening weekend against the Rangers. Don't kid yourself, man. The Rangers highly over-touted, especially with that needle nose on air. He's going to cost him a lot of money and a lot of grief. Mark my words. Two open lines in Dade, 751. So all you sourpusses out there, I love those. Those are my favorite callers, man. Yeah, you're talking too much sports, and we don't like this when he's on. Yeah, so why don't you find something else to do? Go play pinochle. Go play solitaire. You should be used to it. Go do something constructive for once in your life. Oh, my God. It's unbelievable. And, of course, they won't call now because then they'll say, oh, we're gone. We're long gone. Yeah, of course you're not. You're out there right now. You're on the edge of a nervous breakdown. 751-WIOD in Dade. We got two open lines on the green lines. 1-800-944-9463. 1-800-944-WIOD. So we got Monday and Tuesday is the latest that we can see right now. Two more days, two more trips to this joint. And then on Wednesday, we hope that everything will be in order. It's getting pretty close. It's pretty close, and it's space age. It is state of the art, and then some. And they got guys working around the clock over there in our new joint, making it, you can't even believe it. And you'll be able to tell just by the sound of it, just by all the things we'll be able to do. Here's a Lady Mobile in Perrine. Hello.
Hi, Neil. How are you?
Great.
I tried to get on before, but I guess that guy wasted some more time. But I wanted to know if you heard the comment this morning concerning, again, the Alomar incident, but Charles Osgood report?
No.
Okay. I thought it was pretty interesting because he said that he had a way to get back, that the umpires could get back to Alomar just by letting him play, but every time he got up to bat, no matter where the pitch was thrown, to call it as a strike.
They've already done this with guys. That's nothing new.
Right. So they could do that consistently and get away with it?
No.
They couldn't.
Because there's too much spotlight on it now.
Right.
They've done it quietly in the past where they've, you know, squeezed the squeezed pitchers or where they've expanded the strike zone with batters, but there are too many people watching now.
Right, but, I mean, to get their point across, they really could do it.
And let me say it again. It would never get away with it.
It would
create such a black mark on the umpires, I mean, with millions of people watching during the playoffs,
yeah,
that it would they'd never recover from it.
Was an interesting thought, though.
Well,
the report was good, I thought.
I don't agree that the report is good. First of all, it's nothing new. And Dave Pallone talks about in his book at length, which was written years ago, mm-hmm. As much as I like Charles Osgood. And secondly, it's unacceptable. It's like saying, well, we're gonna make a mockery of the game because we're pissed off because the guy did something cruel and grotesque and vulgar.
Right,
It's just not acceptable.
Right. You're right. Anyway, just thought I'd pass on the information.
Okay, sweetheart.
Thank you.
Have a great day.
You too. Bye.
Open line of day at 751-9463, 751-WIOD, and one in Broward, 52421 of Green Lines, 1-800-944-9463, 1-800-944, you know the rest. Here's Davey. Hello.
Hey, Neil, how you doing?
Okay, sir.
I waited for over an hour. I wanted to say hello to Rimmer.
Hi, Rimmer. He's gone.
I'm a first-time caller. I wanted you to know that you got me into hockey. Last season, I was listening to you talk about hockey and decided to go down to a game. Ended up going to about four or five games last year.
Beautiful.
And it's an incredible sport. I'm 30 years old. I was never into hockey. And it just, it's so easy just to get wrapped up in it. It's so exciting.
Right.
Compared to baseball, which I used to be a big fan of. Now it's kind of gotten boring. But the hockey is just incredible. And I just want to let you know that I just want to reward all the Panther fans out there. I have a couple of restaurants. One of them I think you've been to, and I want to give 10% off to all Panther fans for the whole month of October. Have you ever heard of the LJ Diner?
No.
Oh, I have one in Davie and one in Margate. I thought you'd been there.
No.
No? Well, I want to, anybody out there who says they're a Panther fan gets 10% off for the whole month of October, because I'm just really in love with hockey, and I just want to pump up the Panther fans out there.
Okay.
All right? Take care, Neil. You're great.
See ya.
All right. Bye-bye.
Open line in Dade, 751-WIOD. We got one in Broward, 524-9463. And two on the green lines where you got a reprieve again. Boca and West Palm and all those going up there, they got another reprieve, because once we move into the new studios, we still got the green lines. What would life be without the green lines when you come right down to it, huh?
Pleasant.
That's it. Here's a mobile in Hialeah. Hello.
Neil.
Yes, sir.
He's not in love with the Panthers. He just needs business real bad.
Well, both. Maybe one of the above.
In any case, as far as the Alomar situation,
yeah.
I don't agree with the umpires. I mean, I don't agree with what they're doing. But I think that what they're doing is to get their point across that something like that never happens again. Because everybody's saying, well, Alomar is a classy guy. But at that moment, he stopped being classy.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, you're not a murderer until you murder someone.
Yeah.
And I mean, you know, you never see an umpire spit in anybody's face.
You know something? I still don't see what the hysteria about this is. I mean, it was a vulgar thing.
Neither, because if somebody spit in your face, you'd be freaking out, too.
I wouldn't like it, but it wouldn't be the end of the world.
No, but I mean, you'd do something about it if it was in your power.
Like what?
Beat the crap out of me, but I sure as hell wouldn't take it sitting down.
Yeah.
And like I'm saying, umpires as a brotherhood or whatever the hell they want to call it.
Yeah, and that's why, you know, this guy's an entertaining guy, and I'm glad Rimmer got him on. But I knew right up front that he's not going to knock. He's part of the umpiring fraternity. He's on the same crew with Hirschbeck during the regular season in the American League. So this guy's not going to come on here and knock Hirschbeck.
It's not a question of knocking anybody. It's just that if they let this go by, or if they don't, you know, make a big deal about it, I mean, umpires.
Well, how big of a deal are they going to make about it?
I don't know, because until they feel they've gotten their point across.
How much dirt does a guy have to kick in one of the umpire's pants or into his face or on his uniform before they make a big deal about that? That's been going on for years.
I will guarantee you
that when Leo DeRocher and Stanky and some of those guys and Billy Martin were face to face with umpires, I'll guarantee you that there was saliva. They didn't do it the way that Alomar did, but I guarantee you there was saliva flowing back and forth.
That's exactly.
They were right in each
point.
Other's face. That's right. And
because
nobody ever said.
One thing is to get spit mad when you talk, but one thing is to take it. Collect some saliva in your mouth and launch it at somebody's face.
But you have better aim the way Alomar did it, though.
This is true. In any case, I'm torn between the two. I don't think either side should hurt the game to try to get their point across.
That's what I'm saying. I think, let them resolve it their own way, whatever they want to do, but stop screwing the game of baseball because it's already on its last legs.
Yeah, and the fans are the ones that are getting screwed,
right.
As usual.
Let's get the playoffs and the series over, and then the umpires can lock Alomar in a room and beat him up or something. We don't care, but just get the games going.
And in closing, all those assholes that just called and complaining about talking about hockey for, an hour or two?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, we have to, all us hockey fans have to put up with the bullcrap football talk on the station 99.9% of the time.
Right.
So if they don't like it, they can kiss my ass.
Football and boxing, man. Enough with it already.
Unbelievable.
Have a great day, pal.
You too.
See you. Two open lines, and now there's a real good sport, boxing. That's a good savory sport that all you guys can enjoy, the ones that are getting all bent out of shape about somebody spitting in the umpire's face. There's a good savory sport with nothing but really respectable people involved, both in the ring and outside, people like Don King, people who never stole a freight train, real good fights that look real fishy at best and ripping you off from your hard-earned money. But hey, nobody cares about that. 751-WIOD. We got two open lines in Dade. Here's a Lady Mobile in Coral Springs. Hello.
Hi, Neil.
Yes, ma'am.
I wanted to weigh in on the Roberto Alomar situation.
Oh, here we go.
Well, there's one thing I don't understand, and I heard an interview.
Way away.
I heard an interview with Bud Selig, the commissioner, or acting commissioner.
Yeah, the make-believe commissioner, right.
I know. But why are the umpires, like you said, making such a big deal about it when they know full well that the contract between the last labor agreement, the rule is very clear. They don't get suspended for playoff games. It's only for regular season games.
Right.
Selig's got no authority to suspend him for the playoffs.
And they know that they can't go out on strike anyway.
And right. Right. And
which, Jimmy, you heard Jim McKean just say before, he knew that they were going to have to go back to work.
Right. So what are they doing this
for? They're trying to win public sympathy as if it really makes any difference. I mean,
you know,
well, what's the point? What difference does it make what side the public is on?
Yeah,
they have no influence over it either.
We want to see baseball.
Right.
We want to see major league
Those people who are interested in
baseball.
It now during the playoffs and the series, those people want to see the games. They don't give a crap about this anymore. And a lot of the people who are all worked up about this are people who keep seeing this on Channel 7 10 million times an hour. And so right away they're experts and it's something for them to talk about. And they're not even baseball fans.
I don't care who's calling the balls and strikes. Take the college umpires and put them up there. They can call the game.
No, I don't agree with that. You don't play a 162-game season to get to the playoffs so you can make a mockery out of the game.
Well,
I mean, that's just foolish.
We all know that they have to go to work. There's no choice in the matter. They signed a no-strike agreement.
Right, and they're going.
And
the court said they were going, and they knew the court would say they're going.
They're not going to suspend Alomar for the playoffs because they can't.
Yeah.
So, you know, let's get on with the game.
Right. Amen. I'm with you.
Thanks, Neil.
Okay, see ya. Yeah, let's get this stuff going and cut the crap already. And all you people that are so psychotic because somebody spit in somebody's face, one of the mildest offenses that can happen in America on a regular basis in a country where people shoot each other over a parking spot, where we have drive-by shootings. Nobody cares about that. But, boy, somebody spit in somebody's face. Ah, now you're talking. Now you're really getting me pissed off, baby. Uh-oh. Right, back at you. Boy, oh boy, what an echo. Like I said yesterday, and I'll repeat it again today, the public gets caught up in whatever the hype is, whatever the media gets everybody whipped up into a frenzy about, whether it's OJ, whether it's spitting on your puss, whatever it is, the public just dutifully comes along like this is the most important, devastating thing that's ever happened. In the meantime, the people at the NTSB and everybody else keeps lying every day and holding press conferences and lying about this plane that went down, all these people that got killed. Nobody cares about that. And let me tell you, Robert Francis, take your bald-headed puss and give it a rest already. We're sick and tired of seeing you and all these BS stories already, will you? God. Just like I told you, you'll never hear the real story from your government about that deal. 115 at WIOD.
Talk and Entertainment Radio. 610 WIOD.
Rick Riley. Oh, I'm sorry. 117 at WIOD. Hey, well, listen, I'm not, you know, Adam's in here already getting into a big verbal battle with everybody on behalf. Let Rick fight his own fights, okay? And I was wrong about that poll we took the other day. Rumor grew at least a tiny pair before Rick ever even thought about it.
He's going to be upset.
Well, too bad. We got a project to do, okay, here, mister? And we got to grab it by our own hands because we got nobody directing it. Do you know who I'm talking about? We got nobody directing it. Here's Stewart. Hello.
Mr. Rogers.
Yes,
Robert
sir.
From Stewart, sir.
Bad connection. Boy, you got a bad hum on his phone.
It's rainy. It's pouring up here.
Okay.
I heard the tail end that it's DirecTV. It does have the Panthers or...
It's coming, either tomorrow or very soon, but it's coming.
So upgrade now?
I would.
Oh,
you want the Panthers?
Stay by. A truck's going by. Good day, Cam, Mr. Rogers.
Okay.
Bye.
Good phone. Wow. What a hum job on that phone. Open line on the green line, 1-800-944-9463. Here's Tamarack. Hello. Tamarack. Gone? Tamarack is gone. Oh, that's good. That's a good empty spot on the map. Good place for it. Open line at Broward, 524. Here's Miami. Hello.
Hey, Neil.
Yes, sir.
Hey, I live up in Pembroke Pines.
Yeah.
And we have ICS up there.
You have what?
ICS. You ever hear of that?
What the hell is that?
Cable.
Never heard of it.
Yeah, well, they've never heard of the Panthers either because we don't have it. And
ICS.
ICS. I have the 800 number right here.
Yeah.
And
I thought Pembroke Pines was all TCI.
Well, that's our other choice.
What do you mean your other choice?
We have either TCI or ICS.
I never heard of ICS.
Well,
I don't think anybody else did either.
I don't know if they're affiliated or what, but
affiliated with what?
With TCI.
I sure doubt it.
Well, I don't know, but I called them and they didn't know anything about anything. It sounded like
they didn't know anything about anything. Well, that's good. Have a good time with them. Open line and day at 751. Oh, brother, brother, brother. What have I been telling you about cable for years, huh? And now all of a sudden you're getting stuck. And, oh, what do we do now? You're crying on my shoulder like I haven't been telling you about this for, like, ever. Forever and ever and ever. Here's Davey on the purple line. Hello.
Hey, how are you?
Okay.
Hey, this is only 19 minutes. That's pretty good.
19-minute wait?
Yeah, that's
not
good.
Bad, yeah. Well,
not
we cleaned out and started over again, top of the hour.
Yeah. Hey, well, listen, let me just, there'll be a little suck-up action later for you, but all baseball needs to do is extend this debate and lose another couple thousand fans per stadium.
Say what?
All baseball needs to do is extend this debate a little longer.
Right, and lose another 2,000 fans. That's right, and they can close the right. They can just shut down altogether. You're right.
Yeah, I mean, you know, last year's strike. What did that do to baseball? And
just about killed it. Just about put it at the end of their rope.
These people are real intelligent.
Yeah.
That's all I got to say. And the suck-up action is that, you know, sports is at least 25 to 30% of the entertainment in this town. So what you're doing is just following what the people want to listen to and what they want to get involved in. And I remember last year, a year ago, how you let the listeners vent and go on and on about the O.J. trial. And you're just simply following what the listeners and what everybody wants to talk about.
Let me say it again.
Right now, this is the hot item. And you're allowing us
I've been on
talk.
Here for years and years. You know, what I try to do, it doesn't work all the time, but what I try to do is talk about whatever is going on. And right now, with Jim Leland coming into town as the new Marlin manager today, with the umpires having threatened to walk out, with the Panthers season starting tomorrow night, you know, with all this other stuff going on, this is what's happening.
Hey, listen, there's baseball. Erickson's going to get a shot at quarterback. There's a lot
right,
going on.
Right, that's right.
You know, and let me tell you, that last interview with the umpire, I don't care what the other sports station says, that was a great interview, and they ought to take a lesson from you.
Well, and from Rimmer, see, this is the guy they don't want over there because they're intimidated by him. You could tell it, they know each other very well. He knows all the people in sports, not just in hockey, but in baseball, in football, basketball. He knows them all personally. He's got everybody's home phone number. He just had George pick up the phone. Here, call his number. Here's the guy on the phone in 2 seconds. And why anybody wouldn't want a guy like this, unless they're threatened by them, is a very sad comment. So the fat slob can sit over there and keep mouthing off all he wants in QAM. If you really want to hear what's going on, you got to go to somewhere else.
And, you know, you do a great job. Thanks for being around.
Okay, pal. Have a great day. Open line on the purple line, pound IOD. What are you doing, Adam? You're getting me upset.
Going to have to deal with it.
Getting me upset.
We got things to do.
Oh, so in other words, you're going to come in here every day at this time and pull Rick's spots for him?
Uh-huh.
You're going to come in here and pull it? Oh, my God.
Rectum.
Jesus. I don't understand that. I mean, isn't that kind of a bizarre situation? You never did this before.
Mm-hmm. Every morning.
Not in the afternoon. Of course, you weren't producing that show anywhere in the afternoon.
I did Randy's show in the afternoon for a week.
Yeah, and did you pull her spots?
She didn't have any.
Oh, that's a good point. Here's a mobile in Fort Lauderdale. Hello.
Speaking of shoddy umpiring, did you see the game last night?
Yes, I did.
Second, bottom of the ninth inning, the second out there, that called strike three was about 4 feet outside the strike zone.
Right.
Did you see that?
Well, he was making up for the one he called on Klesko earlier in the game that was 6 feet outside. Remember when Ryan Klesko got in his face?
No, I only watched the end of it.
Oh, he called one a strike that way. You couldn't have hit with a 7-iron.
Yeah, it's unreal. It's unreal. I enjoy baseball this time of year. I couldn't give a crap less about it during the regular season.
Right,
so.
And neither could most other people.
Right. I think I've got a good idea for the Joe Robbie and or the Pro Player Park next year when baseball starts.
Yeah.
Call up Channel 10. I'm sure they've got some of Joey Reynolds' old audience standing around there somewhere.
Cardboard crowd, baby.
Can you imagine?
Sure looks better in those orange seats.
Listen to me. There's one thing that you got to play.
Yeah.
I love it, and it sends it all up and down my spine.
Oh, you get chills on your
rectum.
Okay.
Play-by-play on the radio.
Oh, get out of here.
You just heard
that other guy say that now.
No.
Everybody's got chills in their rectum now from play-by-play.
Do me a favor. I don't want to wait, though. I'm in my car. It's raining like hell over
here. Oh, you don't want to wait. Now he's going to tell me what to play and when to play it.
I want it now, man.
Yeah, don't we all?
Hey, and the cart, too.
Yeah.
Play it, goddammit.
Oh, I think you just blew it.
No, I didn't.
Say I'm sorry.
I'm sorry, Mr.
Say I'm
Jackson.
Very, very sorry.
I'm very effing sorry.
Okay.
See ya.
Now it's better. Okay. He didn't say what you thought he said. It was just. We have an open line in Broward, 524-9463. These people, boy, I'll tell you one thing. You won't find, you can't complain about pushy people in South Florida, man, because you sure.
Play by play on the radio. Play by play.
Back. He makes a one-handed catch against the bullpen. Oh, doctor.
Out on the porch in the summer heat, the sound of a southerner's voice filled the street. Me and the redhead were up in the catbird seat. And out in St. Louis, it was surely the same. Holy cow, what a baseball game. The
packs are loaded, and here comes that man again. And it was play by play on the radio, play by play on the radio, play by play, I saw it on the radio. The swing of the splinter, DiMaggio's glide, the men at the mics made it come alive. Bernie and Mel, and Bob was a prince of a guy. Out of thin air, pictures somehow appear. You can smell the hot dogs and taste the beer. Felt the excitement as the crowd began.
Service, pal. Service with a smile. 127 at WID. By the way, Mal Allen's dead, in case you're a little bit behind the times. I know nobody knows who that is. Nobody cared, but that's Florida for you. Kendall Toyota is the largest Toyota dealer, not just in Florida, not just in the Southeast, not just in the U.S. of A., but on planet Earth in the world. That's right. Kendall has sold over 134,512 cars. And if you go down to Kendall Toyota, they'll tell you, you know something? Neil's got a point. Eli is a butt plug. They've got over 1,000 new and used cars in their inventory waiting for you right now, including the brand new 97s. They got a great new 97 Camry, just like the one George is driving waiting for you. New 97 Corolla.